Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Jane Clark and Kathleen McNeil with Clark and Gosler, attorneys at law. Jane is a founding partner of Clark and Gosler. She has more than 20 years of human resources, labor, payroll, and benefits experiences as a law firm attorney, Director of HR at a multi-state Wisconsin company, and as Chief Operating Officer at a statewide comprehensive HR company. At the latter, she directed the Human Resources, Payroll and Benefits practice with for-profit and not-for-profit clients located all over the country. Jane has deep HR, payroll, and benefits experience and is a frequent speaker on human resources, benefits, and management issues. Over the years, she has partnered with established and startup companies and nonprofit organizations in various industries throughout Wisconsin and the U.S. to provide standalone human resources services, as well as integrated human resources, payroll, and benefits services. Jane is also licensed as a broker for life, health, and disability insurance. Kathleen joined Clark and Gosler in 2016. After working as managing partner at Gravey McNeil & Associates LLC for nearly two decades. Throughout her legal career, Kathleen has represented a broad range of employers and employees, including individuals, nonprofit, and labor organizations and corporations. She has successfully represented clients in a variety of employment law matters, including wage and hour issues, wrongful discharge and employment discrimination claims. She has counseled employers on employee discipline and discharge issues, drafted employment contracts, employee handbooks, and restrictive covenants, including non-compete, severance, and confidentiality agreements. Kathleen's prior experience representing employees and labor unions bring an invaluable, diverse perspective to Clark and Gosler's employer clients. While working at Gravey, McNeil, and Associates, Kathleen also served as general counsel to Harlem Globetrotters International, Inc. for 10 years, in addition to working closely with the management team to formulate and implement all personnel-related policies. She helped to negotiate the draft player contracts, sports revenue agreements, and licensing agreements. With their real-world workplace experience and the focused mission and structure of their firm, Clark and Gosler delivers large law firm quality and expertise with a small firm focused at affordable rates. Unlike most law firms, their attorneys also have decades of in-house experience, so they understand the practical realities of applying legal advice. Clark and Gosler clients range from large, multi-state employers to startup businesses and represent all industries in the nonprofit sector. Clark and Gosler's mission is to provide sound, practical advice and options while maintaining the highest standards of communication and responsiveness. In today's edition of the Industry Insider webinar, Jane and Kathleen will cover several hot topics in wage and hour. To begin, they will discuss considerations for bonus pay in overtime calculations, overviewing the differences between discretionary and non-discretionary bonuses, and running through calculation scenarios. Next, we will provide an update on the changing approach to tip pooling between the Obama and Trump administrations. We'll end with updates on current status of the Trump administration's wage and hour actions, including its actual and projected approach to various aspects of the Obama administration's overtime rule. By the end of this session, you'll gain insight into some of the hot topics in wage and hour law. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A feature located on the right toolbar. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. I will now turn the floor over to Jean.
Thank you, Amanda. Kathleen and I look forward to presenting today to all of you intrepid souls who were forced to stay in and not enjoy the beautiful day. So we promise to make this not only educational, but entertaining. As only, Kathleen, don't you agree, wage and hour law can be?
I wouldn't have said that wage and hour was the most interesting part of law a few years ago, but I will say in the last few years, it has probably become one of the most interesting and entertaining areas of the law. So, yes, we promise to be entertaining.
All right, here we go. So, as Amanda said, we're going to start talking about bonus pay in overtime calculations. We'll go through and actually break down calculations for different fact patterns that hopefully you can apply to your workplace. Then we'll talk about changes in tip pooling and tip credits. And then, as best as anyone can, make some projections for anticipated action on employment matters. It's certainly a big change from the Obama administration to the Trump administration, and we're going to try to read the tea leaves and make some projections.
And probably just touch briefly on even only a few of the many different areas that we're seeing some changes to. So we could probably do a full webinar on each and every one of those topics. So we apologize if we're brief, but hopefully if you have questions, we can address them at the end.
Terrific. Here we go. So considerations for bonus pay in overtime calculations. Must an employer consider bonus pay in calculating overtime for the time period for which the bonus was paid? As you would imagine, with any legal question, it's maybe. It depends. It really depends on whether the bonus plan is discretionary or non-discretionary. And determining the answer to that question for the nature of your bonus plan is very important. So let's talk about how we make that determination. So how do we know if a plan is discretionary? These are some of the questions to ask about your plan. Is the fact and the amount of the bonus payment, that's factor one, within the sole discretion of management at or near the end of the time the bonus is paid? And are they paid without any type of contract, agreement, or promise? And if you are answering yes to those questions, then the plan is discretionary, and you do not need to factor it in or consider it when you're calculating regular rate for overtime calculation. So there also is a possibility, even if you didn't answer yes to those, or if you did answer yes to those, that the plan could lose that status. So if you answered yes to those, but it's paid on a regular and recurring repeating basis to the point that employees come to expect it, then it loses that discretionary status. And then it has to be treated as if it were non-discretionary, and you must consider those payments in the calculation of regular rate for overtime. So say, for example, every year on the anniversary of the start of the company, they pay out a bonus, and nobody knows how much it's going to be, but every year it's paid out on the 4th of July when the company started, and employees start banking on that. That plan, even if it's not written down in a bonus plan, even if nobody knows what parameters are looked at in determining the amount, it's very likely that that plan will lose its discretionary status. So how do you know if a plan is non-discretionary? So first of all, is there some express or implied contract, agreement, policy, plan, or promise made in advance? If you've got a bonus plan in writing that is handed out to employees, that is in your handbook, that is posted somewhere on your intranet, or everybody just knows all of the factors that would be considered, that would cause you to answer yes to that factor. Then, looking at that plan, is it drafted in such a way that it has the intent to induce or encourage employees to perform or produce? So whatever the factors are, it's driving employees' performance, how well they do the job, how consistently they do the job, that they're at work, and that in that regard, it's addressing factors such as efficiency, longevity, attendance, individual or group production, the quality of their work, or sales efforts. So if you have perfect attendance bonuses, if you have a stay bonus, something like that, if you are saying if you make 35 widgets in this week, this month, this quarter, if we build this many cars, that would all satisfy those first three. So if you're answering yes to those, then your bonus plan is non-discretionary, and the bonus payments should be factored into the calculation of regular rate for overtime purposes. And we fully recognize that depending on when that bonus pay is paid out, and we'll cover this when we go into the calculation component of this, it can be a real headache to figure out how to attribute that bonus. So when you're looking at your plan, look at these questions. Is it in writing with clear factors and terms? Though, notice in those other factors, even implied. So even if it hasn't been reduced to writing, but everybody knows what the factors and terms are, we have a client where it's not written down, but every single person knows all of the factors that are paid out in it. What are the eligibility rules? Is it all employees? Is it only employees with a certain amount of tenure? Is it written in such a way that even the eligibility rules are qualifying as some of those factors? What pay is considered? Is it hours worked? Is it PTO, sick, holiday, jury leave, bereavement pay? What is the measurement period? How frequently is it paid? And what are the factors to be considered in determining the amount of the payout? And then how is it paid? Is it a lump sum? Is it with every pay period? Is it quarterly? All of that. So just for a little recap here, if it's a discretionary bonus, you don't have to consider it for overtime. If it's non-discretionary, you have to consider it for overtime. I'm a very visual learner. I love slides like this.
Yes, she is. Very helpful.
Then for another little freebie of information here, just a quick reminder to everybody, other payments that are properly excluded from computing regular rate and are not factored in overtime. So that would be gifts to employees, like a birthday gift or something like that. Payments in terms of special occasions, provided it's not based on hours worked, production, or efficiency. So if it's like they're, every 4th of July you give a gift, every Christmas you give a turkey, something like that. Contributions to certain welfare plans. So there has to be an employer plan in place. And so that is considering things like health insurance, dental insurance, life, accident and disability, dental vision plans, flex plans, all of that. It's what you do not consider also is sick time, holiday time, vacation time, or reimbursement for business expenses. So how do we factor in that non-discretionary bonus time in the calculation of pay for overtime calculations? So, of course, nothing can be easy when dealing with wage and hour law. The calculation is very complex, especially in most cases, the bonus is paid out far after people are paid. for the time worked that may have made them eligible for the bonus. So what you do as payroll providers have to apportion the bonus back to the relevant time period in which the bonus is determined to have been earned. So you need to look at the bonus earnings, determine how they can be allocated. Can you allocate it to a specific week or weeks in the bonus pay period? So say we're going to be talking in the context of a quarterly bonus that is paid out for the purposes of these scenarios. So can you allocate it to a specific work week or weeks? Or is it more appropriate to allocate it equally over all of the work weeks in the bonus period or equally over each hour in the pay period within the bonus period? Or looking at your specific work situation, is there another method of allocating that is more reasonable and equitable? And those, you know, I have that in quote because that is the term of art in the wage and hour regulations. So when you can allocate the bonus to a specific work week, then you have to attribute the bonus earnings to that specific work week. So what is that calculation going to look like? First of all, you take the amount of bonus paid out and you divide that by the total number of hours worked in that specific work week, resulting in an hourly increase in pay attributed to the bonus. So I'm doing it by words here. The next slide is actually going to be the math. So your eyes may be glazing over now, and we'll be giving you some concrete information in the next one. And then you take that adjusted rate, and you pay the employee one half of the average hourly increase in pay resulting from that bonus allocated over the week, and multiply it by the number of statutory overtime hours. Now, keep in mind with all of these calculations, at the time payroll was run for that work week in the third week of this pay period or this quarterly bonus period, you've already paid them for their base overtime. You're just trying to figure out now their bonus pay. So you don't, it's not time and a half there. So here's the example. Sam earned a $1,000 bonus, and we attribute it to work he performed in one specific week in February. And during that one specific week, he worked 10 hours of overtime. So you take that $1,000 bonus divided by 50 hours. That's his 40 base hours and 10 overtime. And that division results in an increase of $20 per hour attributed to the bonus. This adjusted rate is then divided in half because you've already paid them, remember. You divide that in half and you multiply that by the number of overtime hours to calculate the overtime pay with the bonus factored in. So you take that 20 per hour from the second bullet there, divide it by 2, which gives you 10 per hour, times the 10 hours of overtime he worked. So Sam, in this example, is getting $100 of additional overtime pay attributable to the bonus for that one work week. And as we go on, you'll see, like, Sam is making a killing on this week. But when you look at the other calculations, it really trickles down to being a pittance. And while you can look at this and say, oh, God, that's a headache, I'm not going to go back and calculate his overtime, as many employers are wont to do, because it is a pain to do these calculations, all it takes is one employee to contact the Department of Labor or on the federal side or the state side, and they open this up and you have an audit for all your employees. And believe me, that will be a much bigger headache.
Yeah, much bigger.
They aren't your friends. All right. So when you can't allocate the bonus to a specific work week, as I said before on that summary slide, you have to look for another method of allocation that's reasonable and equitable. So you have to step back and look for another way to allocate the bonus earnings. So in this case, we're going to say that you can allocate it equally for every single work week of the bonus period. So for that, we'll go then to our summary of the calculations. You look at, for that bonus period over this quarter, in which weeks the employee worked overtime. And then for those weeks, you break down a similar calculation that we said before. You basically take one half of that hourly increase and multiply it by the number of overtime hours. Remember again, we already paid them for the base overtime that they worked. The base pay and overtime during the pay period. We're only trying to figure out the bonus for those, the number of hours that they worked overtime. So let's look at the math here. In the first quarter of 2016, Sam again earned a $1,000 bonus for those 13 weeks. He worked 5 hours of overtime for the last week of February, and that was the only week in which he worked overtime in the whole quarter. So you take that $1,000 bonus, divide it over the 13 weeks, because remember, you have determined he earned it equally over all the 13 weeks. So that gives you a weekly amount attributed to the bonus of 76.92. And then for the week that he worked overtime, you divide that by the 45 hours because he only worked 5 hours of overtime, and that gives you an increase of $1.71 per hour attributed to the bonus.
Poor Sam.
So you take that 171 divided by 2 because you only are thinking about the overtime or the number of overtime hours, and then you multiply that times the 5 hours of overtime, and he is only getting $4.25. Quite a big change from the $100 that he had in the prior scenario. So let's keep going with this. Again, what if you determine those methods aren't the proper way under your bonus plan, but that the bonus is more properly allocated equally for every hour of the pay period? So then what you do is you, you assume that the employee earned an equal amount for each hour of the pay period, and you take that resultant hourly increase, and you determine that by dividing the total bonus by the number of hours worked during the period for which it was paid. And then you continue on with that overtime calculation that we've talked before. So here's the example with the numbers, which I always think is easiest to break it down and actually show you the math. In the first quarter of 2016, Sam again earned a $1,000 bonus, and during that quarter he worked 525 hours. And you're looking at hours here because, remember, you've decided he earned it equally in every hour he was working in that pay period. So there was only 1 week in which he worked overtime, that last week of February. And so you take that $1,000 bonus divided by all the hours that they worked in the quarter, resulting in an increase of $1.90 per hour attributable to the bonus. And then you have to divide that in half and multiply it by the number of overtime hours. So you take that $1.90, sorry, that should be a period, not a comma, divided by 2, which gives you 95 whopping cents, times 5 overtime hours, resulting in an additional $4.76 to poor Sam. A lot of work, and probably given everybody's pay, you're spending more time, it's costing the company more for you to sit down and do this calculation than this fellow is getting paid, but it's what's required under the law.
Wow.
Yeah. It's a lot of work. That's why people like to ignore it.
Right.
But
why lawyers don't do the math.
Right. All right. So a recap. Determine if the bonus plan is discretionary or non-discretionary. Then determine and adopt a reasonable and equitable method of allocating the bonus payments during an appropriate time period, and then follow the steps for the calculation. All right, Kathleen, we're moving on.
All right, thank you, Jane. So as we talked about a little bit in the introduction, the remaining portion of the presentation today is really an opportunity for us to highlight some of the many workplace policies that are undergoing significant change. As you probably know, there hasn't been a lot of federal legislation in the area of wage and law, wage and hour law, but there's been so much going on in other areas that it actually makes our heads spin as we're trying to keep track of everything that's going on, whether it's merely due to the shift from the Obama administration to the Trump administration, or the number of cases before the Supreme Court right now that may have a major effect on wage and hour laws. Certainly conflict between a lot of the circuits right now that we think likely will end up before the Supreme Court, and different approaches being taken by various federal and state agencies. And then finally, too, because there hasn't been much in the way of federal legislation, we're seeing many states push through a lot of different changes, for example, with paid sick leave and drug testing, et cetera. So while for us, the lawyers who find it all fascinating, it's interesting, it's obvious that for employers, it's a really difficult time to know exactly where the law is shifting and to keep track of all the many different changes. So again, we're going to highlight a few of these areas, but they all require us to remain vigilant watching what's going on. And I would highly recommend that you keep in touch with your attorneys or people in your office who are monitoring what the government is doing, because it is changing literally on a daily basis. So one of the first areas we wanted to talk about is the area of tip pooling and tip credits. And by way of background, you know, who is a tipped employee? Technically, that is a legal definition. We all have given tips. I hope most of us have worked in the service industry at some point so that we recognize the importance of tips. But there are obvious categories: bellhops, waiters, bartenders, et cetera. And by law, they're labeled tipped employees because they are employees who customarily and regularly receive more than $30 a month in tips. And why is that important? Well, it's important because then their employer does not need to pay them the minimum wage, right? Federal law requires a minimum wage of $7.25. Of course, many states have different minimum wages, and of course, you always pay the higher of those. But if you are labeled a tipped employee under the Fair Labor Standards Act, then you can be paid less than the minimum wage. And one of the things I just want to make sure everyone is clear about is that even though we are talking about tip pooling practices, by law, also the tips belong to the employee. They are considered property of the employees, and an employer is prohibited from using an employee's tips except in two circumstances: one, as a tip credit, or two, as part of a traditional tip pool. So what is a traditional tip pool? And it might be easier just to explain that, you know, as you might imagine, a restaurant collects tips from all of the employees who are tipped up to 15% and then redistributes them to their other tipped employees. It's a strategy used to equalize tipped employees' incomes and many times to promote teamwork. I'm sure on the flip side, it doesn't always have that effect, but those are the arguments in favor of using a tip pool. So the Fair Labor Standards Act allows these tip pooling arrangements so long as the tip pool includes employees who, and mind the quotes because this is what lawyers love, customarily and regularly receive tips. Okay, clear as mud, right? Not so much. So as a result, that phrase and the use of these tip pools spawned a considerable amount of litigation. And because of that, the Obama administration, the Trump administration, the courts, the Department of Labor, everybody has weighed in on these traditional tip pool practices. So in order for the tip pool to be valid, it can only include employees who, as I said, are customarily and regularly tipped, okay? That we know probably the waitress, the waiter, the bartender. It would exclude most of the back house staff. For example, cooks and dishwashers would not be able to participate in tip pools. You can see sort of the direct table services to guests, any of their activities that seem obvious that lead to the idea of tips. Those folks are valid to be part of a tip pool. And again, here's my friend Jane with her very her very visual look. But again, you know, it is helpful, I think, to sort of break it down. Is the employee's job historically a tipped occupation? Does the employee have more than minimal interaction with customers? If so, they're eligible. And then we give you some examples. Alternatively, is the employee's job historically not a tipped occupation? The position is primarily back of the house, not customer facing. As a result, they would not be eligible to participate in the tip pool. And again, that same example that I gave to you before of the cook and the dishwasher would be two examples of that. Okay, the tip credit, again, another headache in some ways for payroll folks, I'm afraid. But the idea of the tip credit then is that an employer, if they have tipped employees, they do not have to pay the minimum wage. So they receive a credit for the amount, the differential between what the minimum wage is less the $2.13 an hour, which is the federal level, the minimum cash wage that you have to pay tipped employees. Be careful there, folks, because every state has their own minimum cash wage rate, and then some of them are very nuanced. So, for example, in Wisconsin, it's actually $2.33. However, if you're, I think it's under the age of 20 and you've only been in the job for 6 months, it's down to the $2.13 rate. So just be very mindful that it's different in all of those scenarios. So check before you make any assumptions. And then one last note on the bottom of that slide. The employer must notify tipped employees before using the tip credit. Okay, so unfortunately, we lost a little bit of a slide at one point. So based on this idea of the tip pool, employers could use a tip credit so long as they had a valid tip pool, okay? Then came a case. The Cumbie versus Woody Woo is the name of the case. It's one of my all-time favorite case names. And in that case, I'm just looking for my notes here. My slide got a little messed up here, but that's all right. And in any event, it's okay. Sorry, you guys. No, here it is. I got it. Okay. Oh, thank you. We dropped it. In the Cumbie case, it was in 2010. The Ninth Circuit held that if an employer pays minimum wage to its employees, so it's not taking advantage of the tip credit, then the tip pool could include the employees who work in the back of the house. And that would be a valid tip pool. So that's a significant difference, right? At one point, we were looking very much sort of between the front of the house and the back of the house. In this case, they said if all of those employees were paid minimum wage and the employer was not taking advantage of the tip credit, then the employer could require employees to participate in the tip pool, and those tips would be split between employees in the front and the back of the house. Very different from what had been going on prior to that. Well, the Obama administration didn't like that, and as a result, they stepped in, the Department of Labor, with a new rule that stated nope, the restaurateurs or the employers of hospitality workers could not do that. They could not require employees, whether paid minimum wage or not, to split their tips with non-tipped employees. The regulation is there in blue, so whether a tip is to be given and its amount are matters determined solely by the customer, who has the right to determine who shall be the recipient of the gratuity. Tips of the property of the employee, again, which is really the old rule, whether or not the employer has taken a tip credit or not. The employer is prohibited from using an employee's tips, whether or not it's taken a tip credit, for any reason other than that which is statutorily permitted in Section 3M, so as a credit against its minimum wage obligation to the employee. So back and forth, back and forth. Well, as soon as that rule was issued, lawsuits started, and the rule was put on hold. The National Restaurant Association and other hospitality-affiliated associations challenged the regulations right away. And within the process of litigation, the rule initiated by the Obama administration has been stayed since 2013. That litigation has yet to be resolved. But in 2016, the Ninth Circuit ultimately reversed itself and basically said, nope, we agree with the Obama administration. The rule issued by the Obama administration is correct. Employers are barred from utilizing tip pooling policies, including employees who are not customarily and regularly tipped. So, resolved? No, of course not. Shortly thereafter, in November, there was an election, November of 2016. Maybe you heard about that election. And wouldn't you know, the Trump administration takes over in January, and on July 20th of 2017, the Department of Labor announced that it would repeal the Obama administration's 2011 regulations. So this has truly been a pendulum going back and forth, back and forth. The issue is still not resolved. As the Trump administration works to repeal the Obama rule, it's still in place, but they are not enforcing it. So around and around we go. This issue, a side issue related to the tip pooling, also became far more complicated last month. And specifically, that issue deals with the idea of side work. And so in some of the examples that I had given earlier about a waitress or a bartender, are they tipped? Are they not tipped? As we know in real life, it's not that simple, right? Because any employee, tipped or not, some of their duties, some of their tasks are not directly related to the idea of being tipped. For example, a waitress who doesn't have any customers in the restaurant, but simply rolling silver or refilling salt and pepper shakers, or a bartender who's cleaning the bar, those activities could be viewed as directly or indirectly related to tipping. And so the idea of only using the tip credit when an employee is doing work that is customarily results in tips was very confusing. And in an attempt to help employers and really their payroll folks figure out how you pay employees for work that doesn't necessarily generate tips, the Department of Labor issued some guidance in 1988, it was. So looking at this slide, actually, Jane, you want to go to the next one?
Sorry.
Thank you. Is it going? No?
Yep.
There we go.
Sorry.
That's okay. The Department of Labor in 1988 issued some internal guidance that the courts, since that time, have given deference to. And in that blue box, it states, quite frankly, that, you know, it is murky. This is not an obvious distinction to make. But in an effort to help, the Department of Labor issued the statement that if a tipped employee spends more than 20% of his time engaged in related but non-tipped work, he must be paid minimum wage for the non-tipped work. Okay, so it got down to the nitty-gritty, right? Folks in payroll managers are starting to manage how much time tipped employees are spending in tippable work or non-tippable work. So, again, clear as mud. Well, that was basically the way employers had been operating, and we've been relying on that guidance from the Department of Labor, truthfully, until last month when the Ninth Circuit again just
they are a very busy circuit.
They are a very busy circuit and very involved. You might not be surprised. The Ninth Circuit, for those of you who may not know, primarily the West Coast. So think California, Oregon, Washington, Arizona, the West Coast. But just last month, the Ninth Circuit rejected this 80-20 rule on side work and tipped employees. In the Ninth Circuit's opinion, the Department of Labor really didn't have the authority to issue an interpretation that created the 80-20 rule. So in the Ninth Circuit decision, they said, really, that rule is not worthy of any deference. So what do you do now? Likely this will end up in the Supreme Court, we think. It may take a while. And so what do you do in the meantime? Well, if you live in the Ninth Circuit, you have one set of rules, and that would be that you no longer have to follow the 80-20 rule for now. The rest of the country would be wise to continue to follow the guidance provided by the Department of Labor. And so the other issue, too, that we're still waiting for, as I said earlier, and that's referenced on this slide, is basically that while the hospitality industry is celebrating the announcement of the Trump repeal of the Obama regulations, those regulations are still the law until they are repealed. So our recommendation right now would be that employers in the hospitality industry should wait to revise your tip pooling policies until the new regulations become effective. We thought that they would be out sooner. They are not. It is a slow process, probably faster than litigation. But hold on, we'll keep watching, and I would recommend if you're in this industry that you keep watching what's happening with that as well.
So. And ironic that the Ninth Circuit has been so active here because there's been talk about dividing that up because there is such caseload backup. So cases have been pending in that circuit for, in some cases, years.
Yeah.
So when we're talking about federal regulations perhaps beating cases to decisions, that's pretty amazing. So as Kathleen has talked about, it's kind of been like watching a tennis match with your head going back and forth. And we're going to talk about some more changes that are afoot. So we wanted to touch base to one of the big issues in recent years has been the overtime final rule. Not going to dive too deep in a reminder on this, but just basically that $23,660 per year, a huge increase up to $47,476. The highly compensated employee threshold was going to increase $34,000 per year. Keep in mind for all of you Wisconsin employers, Wisconsin doesn't recognize the highly comped employee exemption, but generally you're getting it on duties anyway. The overtime final rule made no changes to the duties test. So it really was looking at those salary increases, indexing, automatic indexing to increase every 3 years, and then it also addressed credits for bonuses. So that was set to take effect December 2016, and just prior to it taking effect, literally all but like four of our clients had already implemented changes. Those who were kind of dragging their feet were lucky because, again, a federal court came in and stated. And all of this really, as Kathleen and I have been talking and preparing for this, it really is an amazing civics lesson to see where the different branches of government are kind of intersecting and how they affect one another so that one district court can stay this entire final rule is pretty amazing. So in the final weeks of the Obama administration, the Obama Department of Labor appealed the preliminary injunction. And then in January, when the Trump administration came in, you can see they abandoned that appeal as it related to striking down the specific salary level threshold. But they did keep the appeal of the court's decision that the Department of Labor didn't have the authority to set a salary threshold. And that's still pending. And there have been several extensions of briefing. But really what this tells us is the Obama administration does want to set their own salary level threshold.
The Trump administration
does want to set their own salary level threshold.
Yeah, and I do think that everyone, regardless of which administration you're talking to, believes that there should be some adjustment. The question is just how great, how soon, how often to reevaluate. So clearly that's at least one thing I think we can, everyone would agree on, that something is going to.
So when the Department of Labor, Trump's labor secretary was going through his confirmation hearing, he, you know, of course, everybody was asking him about this overtime rule. And he indicated at that time that he thought a smaller increase, roughly to about 30,000, so about a 7,000 increase, would be more reasonable. So then in June of 2017, the Trump DOL sent a request for information. So basically what that means is they are asking for commentary from the public on what they think is fair, reasonable, proper, you name it. So what has the response been? So there have been about 150,000 people who have responded with comments.
And those responses, you can find them online, and when you read through some of them, you see they are all over the board on all of these issues.
On both sides of virtually every issue. And it tends to be big associations who are representing large groups of employers who respond. So we're giving you here the response from both SHRM, which is the Society of Human Resource Management, and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which obviously represents all of the local chambers of commerce. And they have made it very clear in their comments that they think the 2016 rule went too far. Both agree that some type of an increase is long overdue, but that they should do it based on the same methodology they had the last time it was increased to the $23,660 and base it on the 20th percentile of salaried workers in the lowest wage region. So the U.S. Chamber and comes in at around the same, almost about 32,000, and both oppose auto adjustments and want there to be some longer stretch of time before you do the pay adjustments with the rule. So another issue that has been discussed is potentially putting in place multiple salary level thresholds. And what does that mean? That means the thresholds could differ based on the varying cost of living across different parts of the U.S. Certainly, what is a living wage in New York City vis-a-vis Oklahoma is a very different dollar amount. So some of the pros of this approach would be that the cost of living varies so much across the U.S., so some type of geo variation helps correct for that. Some of the cons would be it would result in very inconsistent application of the duties test, because what might be a higher pay and get them over the threshold in New York would not be the same in, again, Oklahoma. It's very difficult for multi-state employers. So how do you base it? Based on your corporate headquarters, the local site, or the employee's address? A lot of employers now have isolated employees kind of working remotely out of their homes. And how should the levels be, the differentiation be based on the size of employers, by census region, by state? And really, something like looking at that multiple salary level threshold, you know, to sit back and think about the big policy, the Trump administration's goal has always been expressed as simplifying federal regulations. So we think this would be unlikely, even though the Trump DOL has mentioned it, but it seems like that's going to be too nitpicky for them.
Right, right. And again, very difficult, I think, for employers to manage if there are that many different levels and salary levels. It may just be far too complicated, and it really does contradict the goal of the Trump administration as it pertains to federal regulations.
So some other considerations in here is if there should be that exemption for the highly compensated employees, as we mentioned earlier, Wisconsin doesn't recognize that. I don't think that's going to be that big of a deal, because oftentimes if you're paying somebody enough, their duties will support being treated as exempt. I think probably that came about in the context of more family employers who may be highly compensated, some family member who really isn't doing anything of significance to warrant otherwise being exempt from overtime.
Right.
And then also if there's going to be auto updates. I think it's pretty what we've really would say is looking at something like a U.S. Chamber of Commerce that really represents business. If they are against an auto update, I think it would be highly unlikely that the Trump administration, that has really built itself as being pro-business, pro-employer, very unlikely that they would include an auto update.
Well, and some of this, too, may happen quite slowly. If you're legal nerds like we are, you pay attention to who's filling posts in all of these agencies. And quite frankly, a lot of these posts still have vacancies. Some have nominees who have had their hearings. Others are waiting for their hearings. Some of these positions don't even have nominees yet. So I think it might take a little while for this to be resolved.
Yeah. So look on iCivics.org and get your civic education back up to speed. So this is sort of like an alphabet soup of some other issues that we think are going to be coming down the pipe. And one thing the Trump Department of Labor has said is they are going to bring back the longstanding practice of issuing opinion letters, whereas the Obama administration really relied on administrator interpretations, which were really secretaries' musings on what they think the readings of the law would be. Whereas opinion letters really function as guidance for employers about specific fact situations. So an employer can basically write in, "Dear Abby, but dear Secretary of Labor, I've got this issue. How would you analyze this?" And then the Department of Labor or any other of the departments basically give an answer, and they just block out any identifying information about the employer. But other employers can look at that and equate or distinguish their own fact situations to decide how that might impact their issue. Another big issue, and this certainly is true for the staffing industry, is joint employer. So the traditional definition of joint employer is whoever had direct control over hiring, firing, and setting wages. Then the Browning-Ferris decision, which really came through the NLRB, National Labor Relations Board, added the component of indirect control or ability to exert such control. That directly has had application in the staffing industry, in franchise settings, and a lot of employers have just been curious about that decision. So the Obama administration also, of course, released some guidance on that. And so the Trump DOL withdrew that Obama guidance. But the reality is you still have that National Labor Relations Board decision on the books. And so there is some pending legislation in front of the House of Representatives. I just checked on the status of it. It's been in hearings where they, again, get commentary on it. And that Save Local Business Act is striving to restore that traditional pre-Browning-Ferris definition of joint employer. So let's talk about, you know, I mentioned that National Labor Relations Board. It is Republican-controlled for the first time since George W. Bush. Certainly some of that, the Trump administration's goals is that their areas of focus will be correcting that joint employer decision, correcting the union ambush election rule, and also there has been tons of activity by the National Labor Relations Board on the issue of social media and really cracking down on how employers handle employees' comments and activity in social media, cracking down on employers under the National Labor Relations Act, even in non-union workplaces, because that is thought to be employees complaining about the terms and conditions of employment and talking about it with other employees, which is protected under the National Labor Relations Act. So, but to correct those, we really need to have a case on point in front of the National Labor Relations Board. And Kathleen, do you want to talk a little bit about the makeup?
Right. So this is one of these agencies, again, getting back to the idea of just the difficulty in nominating people to sit on the board, going through the hearing process, being confirmed. We haven't had a full NLRB for quite a while. There are two new members who have recently been confirmed, and so you finally have a full board. However, one of the current members, their term is over, I believe, at the end of this month. So unfortunately, there are so many cases sitting before the NLRB that can't be handled until you have, you know, you have a full working board. So, and I believe the general counsel is, his term is up, although I believe there's somebody who's been nominated to take that spot.
And he's indicated he doesn't want to continue.
So there's just, again, there's just so much going on. It's a whirlwind of activity in wage and hour law.
So then another issue is EEO-1 reporting. So as you all may recall, there was an Obama-era expansion of EEO-1 reporting, which required reporting on W-2 wage information and total hours worked for all employees by broken down by race, ethnicity, and sex within 12 proposed pay bands. So if any of you are responsible for producing reporting for your company, this was going to be a huge headache. People, you know, were putting heat on payroll software companies to come up with a canned report. It wasn't happening, and it's a ton of work. So on August 29th, the Office of Management and Budget announced an immediate stay on that and a review of that Obama-era expansion. So at least for now, for that reporting, which is due in March of 2018, they won't collect that information, and you're just reporting on the traditional data of race, ethnicity, and sex of workers by job category. But stay tuned. There's going to be changes on this. That's stayed now, but I think you'll see the Trump administration trying to do just a broad-scale avoidance of that expansion.
And just quickly, I see that we're almost running out of time, but two other issues that are pending that will affect employers, deferred action for childhood arrivals, otherwise known as DACA, or many people refer to it as the DREAMers. Of course, this was the program that gave protection to undocumented immigrants who were brought into the United States as children and allowed them to work legally. The program has been terminated by President Trump. effective in September, no new applications for benefits were being accepted. And as of October 5th or 7th, I can't recall exactly, any renewal applications were no longer being accepted. So employers should bear in mind that while people have their DACA benefits or their employment authorization documents, they are still legal to be working in the country. But unless Congress acts, the program will end, and when those folks, when their documents expire, it will be unlawful to employ them. The president has indicated he might do something if Congress doesn't. So, again, another issue we just have to keep watching. And finally, the use of arbitration clauses, case before the Supreme Court, whether or not it's legal for employers to require employees to arbitrate any claims they have against their employers and to prohibit them from joining in class or collective actions. And that case was argued last month, and that could have huge ramifications for employers who use those arbitration clauses if they were ruled illegal under the National Labor Relations Act. So I think we're a minute over.
So I don't know if we have time for questions, Amanda, or if because we're at time, people are out of luck.
No, we can go through a few questions here. So open up the floor here. If anyone has any questions, please go ahead and submit them in the chat or the Q&A feature now. Do you have a couple questions that have come in? So we'll start these off. What about your company's Christmas bonus that the company never announces in advance, and we don't know how much it will be, but it is given every year? Is that discretionary or not discretionary?
Well, boy, this is exactly on point with a client of ours. They have a bonus that they have paid out for years. It's always given out on the day of their annual holiday luncheon, and while employees don't know the factors that are used in coming up with it, they rely on it, and there really has never been a year that it hasn't been paid. And so we would tell this employer either change it up or start treating it like it is non-discretionary and should be factored into your overtime calc. And now that one's tough because it's annual, so you would almost have to look at the entire year and assume it's been the same over all the weeks. So that's a nightmare.
Would you also consider that the hourly then, where you would look at it over every hour of every year, the entire year?
Yeah, I think you can make the argument for that too. Right. Because the employer is probably thinking, hey, we did well this year and everybody was pitching in. So you could really break it down by that, which is probably better. And as you can see, breaks down the pay even more. But then you've got to look at all the time that the employee, every time that the employee worked overtime.
Would it also be considered non-discretionary at that point if not all employees received it?
That's an interesting wrinkle.
Yeah. Well, that would bump up the discretion. It would probably also, though, defeat the purpose of it, which is meant to be benevolent at the holidays, and employees probably use it to help buy their holiday gifts for their family. But I think if you dropped the – if there were some people that got coal in terms of not getting a bonus,
ouch.
Then I think that would do something to sway it more of the discretionary.
Okay. Interesting. Thank you for covering that.
Yeah.
Another question that has come in is in the new makeup of the NLRB, is that going to remain more Republican and employer-friendly, or where do you see that going?
Well, I would say that for at least the next 3.5 years, you're likely to see a far more Republican-leaning National Labor Relations Board. Obviously, all of those nominations under a Trump administration come from President Trump, and thus far, the nominees he's put forth definitely lean more employer-friendly. So I think going forward, at least throughout the rest of the Trump administration, the NLRB will likely lean more employer favorably.
Yeah, and all of his appointments thus far have come from big law firms that have a reputation of being very management side, anti-labor.
Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and open up the poll. We thank you in advance for giving any information about today's webinar or some suggestions for future webinars. So if you take a moment to answer a couple questions, that'd be fantastic. I will also move ahead to our next slides here, and we'll close out the session for today since we have run over a little bit in time here. Contact information is up on the screen, so please feel free to reach out to Jane or Kathleen or myself if you have any additional one-on-one questions that they can help you with as it relates to wage and hour law. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next webinar session. We will have a recording available on our website at tricom.com. It is under the Industry Insider Webinars Series tab, so go there for this and other recordings of the webinar sessions that we've had. We are also able to provide handouts for anyone that is interested in that, so please go ahead and email me or Jane or Kathleen if you'd like to have the handouts of today's session to share with others in your office. I hope you have a wonderful day, and thanks so much for everyone sharing your time today, and for Jane and Kathleen for sharing their information on wage and hour review and projections. Thank you very much.